we have learnt the causes of the failure of the revolt of 1857. Why did the revolt fail? What were the reasons? And of course, we further move ahead with the consequences of the freedom struggle movement of 1857. Whenever there is a war, dear children, there has to be some causes, and of course the effects also. These are the effects which we are going to study now, the consequences of the freedom struggle of 1857. The first and the foremost consequence which was seen by the Indians, a very, very important move of the Britishers, that is the end of the East India Company. We have seen that this all started with the advent of the East India Company and its oppressive policies, which harassed the people in every possible way. And therefore, they scrapped the East India Company. It was dissolved, and the East India Company further had no rights to rule the Indian community. The entire responsibility of ruling over India was taken away by the British government directly in their hands. There was one more very important change which they made according to the Government of India Act of 1858, that initially we had the post of the Governor General, but then with this Government of India Act of 1858, this post of Governor General was now designated as the Viceroy of India. That means after this, you would always learn in history till we attained independence that we were ruled by different viceroys. Lord Canning, who was the last Governor General, got the post of the first Viceroy of India. Very important for you to remember. That is, Lord Canning was the last Governor General and he was given the charge to be the first Viceroy of India. Moreover, there was one more post created, that is the Secretary of the State, specially created by the British government to look after all the affairs of India. So, though the company's rule ended, still the Britishers took every possible care that the British government will have full control, full sway and supremacy over the Indian land. And therefore, they created posts like Viceroy of India, they created posts like Secretary of the State, and thus they kept on ruling India as per their whims and fancies. But dear children, the Britishers were very smart because they had well understood, because of the revolt of 1857, because initially it really shook the British rule in India. They had to face defeat at the hands of the revolters. It was a great setback, and therefore they were clever enough to understand that if at this point of time, if they do not pacify the Indians, if they do not take care of their needs, or if they do not take every possible care to calm down this unrest or this agitation or this retaliation, it would be difficult for them to have complete sway over India in the coming years, which they wanted to do. They wanted to have full control and supremacy over every part of Indian territory, and therefore they brought a few reforms through the Queen's Proclamation, which tried to please the Indians and pacify them, make them calm, and so that the Indian mind would get diverted and the Britishers would get another chance to have control over the Indians or Indian administration. Now, what did Queen Victoria declare in her statement, in her draft? The first thing what she said was, all Indians are our progeny. Progeny means children. All Indians are our children, or they are our subjects, They are our people, and therefore we have full right to take care of our subjects of or our own people. Likewise, she also said that there would be no discrimination made on the basis of race, religion, caste or birthplace. Government services or government jobs would be given only on the basis of merit. And most important declaration which was made, because that was the cause of the revolt of 1857, that henceforth the Britishers would not interfere in the religious affairs of the Indians. If you remember the causes, the social causes and the religious causes, you have come to know that even in the Indian sepoys, that is, there was a total unrest because the religious sentiments of the Indian sepoys were disturbed, because they had to tear the cartridges which were made of the fats of cows and pigs, and cows and pigs were sacred to the Hindus and the Muslims. Seeing all that, the Britishers had learnt a vital lesson, that it's no point interfering in the religious matters, the social matters of Indian community, because they had much more plans in their mind that once we have a firm hold over Indian administration and Indian politics, these small little things, petty little things can be taken care of later as well. So initially they declared, the Queen's declaration said that from now on they won't involve themselves in the religious matters and the social matters of Indian community. Moreover, they also, the draft also said that the Queen or the British administration will respect all the treaties. Treaties are the pacts or the agreements which are signed between the princely states, the kings and the British government, or maybe between any two kings. These are known as treaties. In today's language, it can be said as MOU, that is between two companies when a deal is signed. What do they sign? They sign a very, very important term you must have heard, that is they sign the MOU. That is minutes of understanding. So there were treaties or agreements or deals or pacts which were signed between the British government and the princely rulers or the local rulers or the Indian rulers or the kings or the Nawabs or the Nizams, the Marathas. So all these pacts or the deals which would be signed would be definitely accepted and honored by the Britishers, particularly the Queen. Another very important declaration which was made by Queen Victoria was that after this revolt, the British government would never ever annex or capture any of the princely state. No Indian kingdom, no Indian king, no princely state would be attacked and captured or annexed by the Britishers after this. So all these were very, very important declarations which were made by Queen Victoria. The next is change in composition of the army. If you remember, dear children, that the immediate cause of the revolt was the discontentment in the Indian soldiers, and the outburst also took place among the Indian soldiers only. And therefore, the Britishers were very, very wise enough to make strategic planning and strategic moves in the composition of their own army. Composition is the way the Britishers had placed their army, the number of soldiers, the arms and ammunition which they had. They replanned everything, and they did it because this was the trigger point of 1857 revolt. Now, what did they do? The number of British soldiers was increased as compared to the Indian soldiers because again they wanted to have good hold over this area as well. The English officers, particularly the British officers, were given postings at very strategic locations. Strategic locations are important locations, very sensitive locations where there might be another unrest, there might be another outbreak of revolt. Wherever they felt that these are sensitive locations, there they placed their English officers, more in numbers particularly. Then this particular area of the British Army, that is arms and ammunitions and artillery, was exclusively kept in the hands of the British, because if you remember, again, the introduction of those long rifles and the cartridges. So here they understood that there can be misuse of the arms and ammunitions at the hands of the Indian soldiers. And now they did not want to run any kind of risk, because they had tested defeat in the revolt of 1857, and therefore they took every possible care that it should not happen again in future. And so artillery was kept exclusively under the British sway, control. But the British did not stop taking all possible care. They went ahead of creating differences in the minds of the Indian soldiers on the basis of caste. This was the time from where the seeds of division started in the Indian community. The Indians were divided on various reasons by the Britishers, because they had understood that if Indians would come united again to fight against us, it would be difficult for the Britishers for the next time to give a good fight to the Indians. And therefore, now they wanted to create such situations wherein the Indians would never get united. They would keep on fighting amongst themselves, and it would pave way for a complete hold of the Britishers over Indian territory. And therefore, they started sowing the seeds of division in the Indian military on the basis of caste, Indian soldiers on the basis of caste. Moreover, they also ensured that the Indians will not get united and rebel again against the Britishers.